What's up, guys? Welcome back to the
Hearthstone World Championships.
I actually haven't introed the show yet today, I didn't have that top of my head. But anyways, I'm here with Azale and Reels, and we are bringing you the next match, which is going to be Kranich going up against Green Sheep. And Green Sheep, you know, a very young kid from the UK, did a great job in the EU qualifiers, whereas Kranich, you know, the Koreans didn't do too well overall in the last OGN tournament, but he did well enough that he was able to play for the spot and get into here. So I think he's actually a little bit of an underdog here.
Okay.
I agree. I think he is a little bit of an underdog as well. Green Sheep, hailing from Team Dignitas. I think he's from the UK. Mm-hmm. And I imagine he'll be the favorite in this particular match. I wouldn't go so far as to say that he's a favorite for the tournament as a whole, but I'm sure he's very hungry for it, and maybe he'll surprise us, and maybe Kranich will surprise us and end up. He is the underdog, so maybe he'll be stronger than we thought.
Well, you know, the thing is, there's so much money here at BlizzCon for the World Championships. Like, you win 100 grand. I think every player in this tournament has probably done nothing but play Hearthstone for maybe months leading up to this. And, you know, for instance, Green Sheep, like, he made some mistakes while he was playing at the EU Finals, but
he did 3-0 his final series, though.
Yeah. Overall, he played quite well. Like, there were a few misplays, but there's a lot of pressure there, too. You know, his first big event and everything. So I'm looking forward to see how much he's actually improved.
Yeah, they're both definitely motivated. Hmm. And I imagine you're absolutely right. They have prepared the best they think they possibly can for this event, and we will see them at their best.
Yeah.
I mean, I think there's no more motivation needed than, you know, there's no more exposure you're going to get from any tournament. There's no more of a prize pool they can get from any tournament. So it's like, you know, if this
BlizzCon
is the tournament to go all in for, it's BlizzCon, yeah.
You're completely right. Like, this is going to give you the most views. This has the most prestige. Like, there's nothing in the world like BlizzCon. Well, I guess you two know pretty well, being ex-BlizzCon players
yourself.
I've played
here a number of times, you know, and it's definitely incredible.
That's right. Looks like Green Sheep has only brought three classes. Oh, okay, four classes.
All right.
His Shaman actually banned here. That's kind of interesting from Kranich. What do you guys think about this?
Well, you know, in the interview we had earlier, it seems like some of the Asian players like aren't actually feeling like you need to ban the Warlock as much. They were saying that they felt like, you know, you could ban some of the other classes. And earlier they were saying that he thought that he should have banned his Rogue and not his Warlock, even though he was getting wins with the Handlock. Mm. I guess it's just maybe different meta, different things like that that they're more worried about. Or it could be kind of specifically tailored decks.
Yeah, I guess it could be. You know, it's interesting because the different areas do have different metagames for sure. I've played a bit on the other ladders and stuff. You know, I think NA EU is pretty similar. Maybe NA is normally a little bit more aggressive than EU, I find.
Right.
But when you jump over to those Asian servers, they are a bit different. So, let's go ahead real quick, though, and learn a little bit more about these players.
My parents at first were not very keen on me playing this game, but after they've seen my recent performances and they've seen the opportunities I can get by flying across the world, they started supporting me more and more, and I'm really thankful for that.
I think Hearthstone is very fun and I really enjoy every game. My favorite card in game is Captain Greenskin, because it sounds really cool.
My name is James Luo, also known as Green Sheep in-game. I'm 16 years old and from the United Kingdom.
I'm Kranich, and I'm 23 years old, and I'm from South Korea.
My favorite card in the game, although it's not played much, is Demolisher, because it's just like a mini Ragnaros, and you can play down early, and you can see where it hits, and it's just really interesting to see if it hits the face or hits a minion.
I really like to play Hunter, because I feel really cool to just go face to my enemy. My first opponent is Green Sheep, and I think he's a good player, but he's quite new in this Hearthstone scene. I think I can beat him.
Okay, so we learned a little bit about those players right there, and it's just about time to get into this game. Of course, Shaman is banned over here, and it was
the Warlock, I believe.
It was Warlock banned, I do believe. I think you are right.
Okay.
And that would make sense, too. I think a lot of the Western players are banning Warlock at this event, so.
Yeah, definitely.
Some Hunter bans.
Pretty rightfully so.
Yeah.
Yeah, we've seen a little bit of Hunter ban, we've seen a little bit of Warlock ban, and some other stuff mixed in. I think we saw, like, a Rogue ban, and this is the first Shaman one.
It was interesting, you know, I saw Savitz on Twitter earlier. Mm-hmm. He was saying that he thought that banning Hunter was just a horrible move. He doesn't think that with the Buzzard being weaker, he doesn't feel that it's worthy of a ban anymore. So it's interesting to hear, you know, players obviously just have such different opinions on strengths and weaknesses, obviously based a lot on what kind of playstyle they have and their individual success.
It's kind of interesting because just 2 weeks ago at Sea Story Cup, like, I would say at least 50% of people were banning, like, Hunter and 50% banning Warlock, something like that.
Yeah.
So to see how drastically this has changed and the fact that, like, recently at the Vigame House Cup as well as Sea Story Cup, we saw, like, a lot of success with Mage. Here, only one Mage deck has even been registered.
Yeah.
I don't even know what to say about these things, guys. It's crazy.
I mean, the meta can change so fast in games like this. I mean, all it takes is one person coming up with a deck that beats a previous deck, and then people are like, oh, no, it doesn't work anymore.
Yeah.
Learned how to speak English by watching Twitch. That is something. And his English was amazing.
Yeah, yeah. It's really, really good.
Yeah.
I'm actually quite impressed.
I'm quite shocked.
I actually hadn't spoken to him before, but very good English. So we will be getting right into this game. It looks like we're going to have Hunter going up against Shaman to start this out. So any predictions?
I mean, I do feel like it's slightly Hunter favored. It definitely depends on the decks. It depends on the kind of Hunter. I mean, I definitely think at least Face Hunter is, like, pretty, you know, favored. But this is interesting. It is Knife Juggler, which leads me to believe it's probably, like, Unleash and stuff as well.
Yeah, and Snake Traps.
Yeah, exactly. And that stuff, I think, is definitely pretty solid against Shaman. But if you can get early minions out of Shaman, I think you definitely stand a pretty good chance.
We saw...
Ooh, good hand for Shaman. Like, really nice hand.
Yeah, and 200 creepers, yeah.
We saw Shaman beat Hunter once already.
Yep.
I'm thinking we may be able to see it again, so I'm going to say Shaman's going to take this one. Greenwich's going to get game one. Oh, but the Undertaker draws. Oh, there's something you want off the top of the deck. That's it.
That is it. But
he does
perfect
have the answers,
hand.
Though. Yeah, I mean, he can Lightning Bolt. He can go with Urshock as well. You know, it does kind of suck a little bit to start overloading this early. And, you know, if the Hunter continues to draw those minions, then...
Yeah. But, you know, he's going to just overload for one, which means he can place Haunted Creeper the next turn. This is, like, a pretty darn solid play right here.
Yeah, definitely.
Couldn't be happier as a Shaman to start like this, really.
No, not at all.
Yeah, the one mana removal spells... quite good against the hyper-aggressive start of the Hunter deck occasionally. It sometimes costs you life, but it's not even using a Rockbiter this time. It's just outright removal. So,
Well, he's definitely slowed this deck down quite a bit. Harrison. Very, very cool to see that here.
Especially pretty common so far in the tournament.
Yeah, a lot of Harrisons. Actually, very specifically in the Asian scene, like China and Korea, we see so many Harrisons, it's crazy.
Yeah,
almost every deck has Harrison.
I actually really like that. I mean, it's a pretty game-changing thing in this matchup. Mm.
And that Stranglethorn Tiger is just a card in the deck. That did not come off the web spinner.
Yeah.
Oh my god.
Yeah, that's just an actual Stranglethorn Tiger. So,
what do you think about that?
We do see one Stranglethorn sometimes in these decks. I've never seen one Stranglethorn in the Knife Juggler type Hunter decks that normally play Unleash and Snake Trap and all that good stuff. So I'm a little bit caught off guard by it there. But, you know, it's kind of just like straight up 5 damage plus it enables Kill Command in the late game. So it's like a pretty good finisher overall.
Yeah, it's actually a reasonably strong minion. Yeah. The Stealth is quite powerful on a 5/5/5. And you're absolutely right about the Kill Command. It makes sure that it sticks in play as well as possible.
Taking a look here, I think you think he's going to go ahead and set this off.
Yeah, I mean, okay. So you know, he definitely knows what it is now. Do you think he should Harrison here before he gets the extra charge? Do you think he's waiting for the extra card draw, or do you think it's more important to remove it now? I mean, I feel like you should for sure remove the weapon. Yeah,
You don't need the extra card, really.
If you start
getting greedy against Hunter,
I think that's the worst thing
you can do.
Yeah, when he was mousing over the Turdrake, it was making me a little bit worried. Yeah. I was like, oh, God.
All right. Looks like his continued build's bored quite a bit here now.
Now, honestly, I mean, with that Harrison having been played, it's pretty game-changing. He lost not just the one charge. He lost the second with the Snake Trap being down.
Would you guys go ahead and remove all the spiders here? Like, is this, you know, a lightning storm? Just try to clean this up.
It is really tempting to play the lightning storm. It's pretty hard not to, even. he just wants to play the Drake instead. It's turning it into a bit of a race.
Yeah, I think he just doesn't want to proc the Snake Trap. I think he's just going to go face.
Well,
yeah.
You know what? At 30 health,
Rock
I think it's
Biter
not terrible.
Flame Tongue too. I mean, that's a lot of that potential damage here.
By turn 9, he's going to kill him.
Yeah.
Like, that's just straight up going to happen.
Yep. Double Unleash, it could be the play here.
Mm.
You know, we'll see what he's going to be able to get done, but definitely should be able to do something.
Dem Haunted Creepers. Mm. They're actually doing work. They were both damaged there.
Like, yeah, and this does set up for the Lightning Storm very nicely for next turn,
yeah.
especially if he uses that other Haunted Creeper. It looks like he is going to hold on to it. Yeah, exactly.
So everything is going to die to Lightning Storm,
yeah, this
actually.
Is like,
his opponent's at 27.
Yeah, yeah.
The advantage here of Kranish is actually
massive, insane.
Like,
yeah, and I mean, having a Hex in hand is pretty nice as well, just for the additional answer. You know, if a high main or something were to come down.
Kranish is a joker, by the way. You see this stuff?
I hope he doesn't end up misclicking off of that at any point. That would be tragic.
Yeah.
But it's kind of at the same kind. You can't really complain if you're doing it nonstop, and it does happen.
We've seen a couple of misclicks recently that were pretty tragic.
Yeah, well, the rope earlier.
Oh, this
the sickest, worst
Dude,
rope of
I
all
know.
Time.
I was I would have been sick if he lost that game after that.
He would have too, believe me.
Yeah.
River Croc is not the worst thing to get off of Web Spinner, but this is a really tough circumstance to be excited about River Croclus.
I think that's an understatement.
I think you don't need to worry about that, Reels. I really don't think he's excited about the River Croc here.
I think that's fair to say.
Yeah.
Some expert caster analysis here.
Well,
that's why they passed the big bucks.
Mm-hmm. There's the possibility of getting the captain's pair right.
Yeah.
That's the nightmare. But
well, wasn't he saying that Captain Greenskin is his favorite card?
He probably does
what
like parrots.
What is better
then?
Than that?
The parrot. The parrot that rides on his shoulder.
Yeah, well, the parrot that gets him.
Yeah, there you go.
It's all about that Doomhammer Captain Greenskin.
Oh, yeah, that's the sickest play.
And he's seen one lightning. Yeah, he knows at this point it's...
Yeah, it's getting rough.
The race is on, and... Is he just dead, though?
Yeah.
Yeah, I
that's
mean...
That's 12, 13, 14, 15, yeah. 16. That's exactly 16.
Yeah, exactly. He has the Alakir Rockbiter, so...
It was going to be hard for him to not kill him by turn 9 with that hand, really, how this game went early on.
Yeah, and we do get to see Shaman defeat Hunter yet again.
Dude, maybe Savitz is right and people should not be banning a Hunter. Like, Shaman's beating it, Handlock's beating it. People are not even... Like, we're watching people ban Paladin instead of Hunter and stuff like that. It's a little bit crazy.
Yeah. To be fair, though, I feel like the Shaman basically had an ideal hand. And I think especially even having, the turn 5 weapon removal, that is so big. He had, on turn 2, he had the Lightning Bolt to remove the buff Undertaker, as well as the Urshock to not even take the damage from the Leper Gnome. I mean, this
pretty
is pretty much like a dream hand and mana curve for the Shaman in this kind of a matchup.
Yeah. Doesn't really get any better than that.
No, if you can just remove both right then, and then he also has the double web spinners, like, once you get rid of Undertaker, there's very few minions that actually live through the...
And I mean, he had the Lightning Storm to remove everything after the Snake Trap came down. I mean, it was pretty much dream hand, I think, for the Shaman. He played it very well, but I also think it's like, you know, it's hard to read too much in games like that because, you know, they can happen.
Well, it looks like his next deck, is going to be a Warlock deck.
Okay.
You think it's Zoo?
I think we might see Zoo, yeah. I think there's a good chance it'll be Zoo.
I don't think you really want to pick Warrior into Shaman.
No.
So...
Yeah, I mean...
Like, I generally don't like
reasonable.
It. Like, a lot of... Not many people are playing Baron Geddon anymore.
Right, yeah.
You'll have your Brawl, sure, but it... You know, it's a little bit dicey actually dealing with all those totems in the late game.
It can be really difficult.
Well, and we did just see he has the weapon removal as well. Like, you know, he does. That's something to keep in mind.
Yeah. So, yeah, I think this is a pretty good pick no matter what it is.
It's definitely a good choice. I think it's a good answer regardless of whether it's Handlock or not.
Yeah.
Both of them do fine against Shaman. And I hope kind of that it's Zoo. Because I think
Zoo is a better matchup against Shaman. I mean, I definitely think that both can beat Shaman, but at the same time, Shaman can also beat both. A lot of it, obviously, you know, against Handlock, it really does come down to having, you know, the turn 4 answers. If you have the Hex or the Earthshock, you know, that really is game changing. But Zoo, I think, even sometimes when you do get the Lightning Storm and stuff, it can be tough. But, you know, Zombie Chow is a pretty nice start if it was, but obviously it's not.
Yeah, okay. And
but it's going to be the Handlock.
Yep.
He'll keep the Zombie Chow, obviously.
Do you think he really holds the Lightning Storm? Do you think he's greedy enough? Okay, never mind. Because, you know, sometimes against Zoo and stuff, if you do want to try to hold those, and obviously if it does turn out to be Handlock, you're pretty sad.
Yeah.
Yeah, and you didn't even consider it.
Yeah, no.
You didn't even... Yeah. Didn't even click it back and forth a couple
ladder,
times.
I might have been too greedy.
That's funny. I missed part of the games in the first match. Was there any Zoo in there?
Not in the first match.
Okay. So
there was
no Zoo yet in the tournament.
There was one Zoo. Didn't you guys test a Zoo game?
Yeah,
you guys
did.
Oh, God. Yeah, I did. Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Whoa.
Yeah, but just one Zoo.
I was testing you guys. You pass.
Thank you.
Congratulations. All right. Well, taking a look at this hand. Has some weapon removal of his own with that ooze.
Yeah.
That ooze has been pretty popular today as well.
Yeah, we already see though Urshock in hand, so it's gonna be pretty key whether he goes for the Drake or the Mountain Giant. I mean, if he goes for that turn four Drake, that having that answer is pretty huge.
Mm.
And you know, right now we see no real answer to the Giant, so I think a lot of it could actually come down to that turn four play can make a pretty big impact on the game.
The Giant is super huge against Shaman sometimes.
Yeah, but if you have
sometimes
the hex,
it's not.
Sometimes you know, even sometimes, you know, some of the Rockbiter plays and things like that can make a big difference. So,
yeah.
I mean, especially with two Twilight Drakes in his hand, do you feel like that's probably the play that's going to happen here?
The Twilight Drake?
Yeah, looking like it.
The Twilight Drake comes down first often.
Yeah.
Because if they don't have Earthshock.
Yep, just soaks up so much.
Yeah.
The hex draw is pretty big.
Then you're like really sad.
Right, exactly.
Yeah, that hex draw is
really
pretty fantastic
for their Mountain Giant, because he wouldn't have anything to deal with it. But once again, I mean, you talk about if you have to hex the Drake, it can be pretty frustrating.
Yeah.
You know, we could just see another Drake come down here, which to me seems like the play that makes the most sense.
Yeah.
You know, having seen one Earthshock played, do you really think he's going to have the second? Probably not. And then it does sometimes get a little bit awkward dealing with that, because you know it's not very efficient to dump all those minions into it, having to use your you know, your Rockbiter and things like that. And at the same time, you don't really want to hex at all.
My question is, what happened to Double Doomhammer, man? We're seeing Alakir, and there's nothing wrong with Alakir.
Yeah.
I like Alakir just fine.
Alakir's okay. We're on talking terms, but I'm not the biggest fan.
Double Doomhammer was really cool, man. Dual wield Doomhammers.
I like Double Doomhammer. I like how clunky it is. Makes me feel like a kid again.
Do you think?
Like, I love this card, and just put two in the deck.
It's also a ridiculously awesome looking golden card.
Yeah,
Alakir looks good, but Doomhammer's amazing.
I almost have all of the Shaman in Golden. I have like almost a full Shaman Golden deck now. It looks so cool, dude. The Fire Ellie is one of the coolest looking cards as well.
Listen, okay, I don't know if you guys have. Oh yeah, I know you've seen a Golden Sea Giant.
Yeah.
Turning wheel on the belt.
This game might end, by the way. I know we're having some fun right here, but
the Lilith
means that the game might just end.
You're right,
next turn.
Actually.
Yeah.
It, because he has, of course, Doomhammer plus
Rockbiter.
The Rockbiter, and
yeah.
That is a ridiculous amount of 10 damage.
He basically has to play a 5-mana Soulfire on the Zombie Chow if he wants to live.
Wow.
Which is insane.
Yeah, and I don't think he will. I mean, do you think he does? Okay.
Oh, wow.
Oh, wow.
Wow, well done.
Yeah, but Acidic Swamp Ooze gets discarded, so
wow,
now...
Wow, he needed that.
Yeah.
The coast is clear.
Yeah.
Doomhammer might come out anyway. And being a 21, though, okay, so the Hex is going to come out. And that's good, too. Maybe it'll mean that the Feral Spirit is the play. I think actually coining Defender of Argus could be pretty strong as well.
Mm.
It gets a lot of damage in right now, and it makes your board a little bit
exactly
more
exactly how much damage you want to bring him down to right now.
I mean, I think with Rockbiter plus Doomhammer, you have the 10 there, plus you have a fair bit on the board. I don't think you really want to bring him below like 15.
Yeah. So, I mean, I'm liking this, what he's done here.
This looks good. I mean,
he could have done like maybe one more damage or so, but...
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, it's like, you know, if he's looking at Hellfire here, but there's no really great plays. I mean, you could Hellfire and then heal yourself up, so you could put yourself back at 16. I think that's going to be the play.
Yeah,
do you think he Soulfires? Yeah.
Yeah, you have to Soulfire here.
So
this
too.
Is too scary.
Yep. Oh, he's not going to.
Whoa. This time he's not going to.
He's
going to
he can put him at 1 HP, and in my opinion, now you just, there you go. That's. Like,
he doesn't have enough mana.
He doesn't have mana this turn. Oh, do you think you go just equip the Rockbiter?
You can take him to 1.
Do you think you just put on the Doomhammer anyway?
Yeah, you put him to 1 because he's already used this. Like, I mean, he's got to do Taunt plus Life Gain.
Yeah.
And if he can't do taunt plus life gain, the thing is, if he does taunt plus life gain this next turn, then he can Jiraxxus next turn, and then you're like, uh-oh, I used up everything.
Yeah, right. But I mean, you have to go for it in that situation. It's like almost a guaranteed one.
Yeah, it's so close to one.
I love the aggressive
Faceless
plays.
Faceless isn't going to do anything.
Yeah.
It's players oftentimes, especially against the Warlocks, especially the Handlocks.
Yeah, that's game.
I think it is.
He can siphon. He siphons, but there's still 4 damage. Plus, he has the 3 from Lightning Bolt as well. So, I mean, he's going to have lethal by 1 damage. Yeah. Or he's going to have lethal by a couple
damage. Yeah, no matter what.
Yeah, more.
Yeah, there's nothing he can do.
Yeah, he's like, all right, well.
And that's
going to soulfire himself.
Yep.
Honorable.
Wow.
Well.
GG.
I know that this is not how Green Sheep wanted it to go starting off. Very, very powerful shaman play so far. And it's been a great curve of things to do, removal, monsters into giant burst. And that's really where shaman is at its best. And we've seen it 2 games in a row. Sometimes they falter and get hands that don't really line up very well against what their opponent is doing. But
Having the Hex and the Urshock early really does just turn the tide of the game completely.
Oh, against Handlock, absolutely.
Yeah. I mean, being able to control the board like that, just the Urshock is so insanely good.
If you don't have like a complete garbage hand and you have an Urshock and he plays a turn 4 Twilight, you're
going to
win that game a lot of the time. Like, it's going to be very hard for them to ever come back.
70 or 80%.
Yeah, it's big. It is certainly big.
Because I would say, at least just from my experience this way, I play Shaman basically all the time, and I think it's, it's a pretty winnable match even when you don't get that. It's like maybe 50-50 or around there, I think. And if you get that turn 4
Most people agree it's right around. It's pretty even, most people think.
If you get the turn 4 Earthshock, it's pretty damn
good. It's pretty sick play.
Yeah.
You can hold your Twilights. Kalento taught me this. This is one of my favorite moves now, is to actually just hold the Twilight and not let them get a 1 mana for 4 mana turn, because that's just so gross. But
especially early in the game.
Yeah.
So do you feel he should have, even with the double Twilight, do you think he should have gone for the Mountain Giant?
I don't remember what he mulliganed, but I think he should have gone Mountain Giant.
Yeah, he had the Giant in hand.
It would have gotten Hex, as it turned out.
I like mulliganing for Watchers and Owls. Mm-hmm. Savitz told me about that, and I tried it out, and it definitely helps to help clear that board a little bit. But anyways, it wasn't going to work out. No matter what, the Shaman deck just absolutely killing so far.
And now Green Sheep down to just Warrior. He has to reverse all kill with Warrior against Shaman and Warrior and was Warlock or Hunter?
It was Hunter. I think Warlock got banned.
It's doable. It is doable. Like, it's not as if Warrior can't beat Shaman.
Yeah. Oh, it absolutely can. Yeah.
We'll have to see what he has in his Warrior deck, of course. Some cards really help out in this matchup. For instance, if he is playing Baron Geddon. Some people have played 2 Brawls. I don't know if he's doing that, but...
And Harrison Jones.
Against a Doomhammer, that's a win.
Yeah.
It could happen. It does happen sometimes.
And speaking of the double Doomhammer, just watching the meta so far with all the weapon removal, all the oozes, all the Harrisons, I think that's a pretty good reason alone not to play double Doomhammer.
Yeah, you're absolutely right.
That's true. Well, no, because then when it gets Harrison, you have another one to back it up.
That's the counter. That's the counter to it.
Come on now. You got to look at the bright side of things. You're such a pessimist.
I apologize. I retract my statement.
That is probably a big part of it, though. And you're absolutely right. Yep. Is people are playing more oozes, and we've seen a ton of Harrisons, which that happens sometimes. Yeah. But part of that is because people are playing things like double Doomhammer lately.
Yeah. And it's sometimes it's one of those things that's kind of like a one-trick pony type thing. It's like you can bust it out once in a tournament. People aren't expecting it. They don't have the decks properly prepared for it. But to do that, repeatedly seems pretty tough.
Now, it's probably not going to be a stock deck forever, that's for sure.
I mean, with 2 Urshocks in hand, it seems like you have to Urshock 100% that. Yeah, 100%.
You have to.
Yeah, like, I don't think there's...
You have to deny the draw on a Warrior.
Yeah.
I'm not sure why you wouldn't. And it is a bit unfortunate for Green Sheep here. He's kind of put into a position where most of his hand is not anything he's going to be doing anytime soon. He really...
did want to dig.
Yeah, he wanted to get that Acolyte and get at least a card out of it. Sadly, he gets 0
extreme
instead.
Value, man.
Yeah, not just 0, but it's going away all the way, so. Doesn't even do any damage. 1 damage to face. Ouch.
Not the best card for Warrior control. That's not where you want to be. Well, some options for Kranich, though, and he needs to decide how he wants to develop his board. And so far, I guess it's just going to be a totem fight.
Yeah, why not? And you may as well play the Zombie Chow now. Yeah. If you're not going to play it now, when in the world exactly. are you going to play it? And it, your opponent's like armoring up this early in the game. He only has late drops. Just play it out.
Yeah, I mean, it's such a dead card later in the game. There's like, more often than not, you don't even want to play it.
It's like, it's like maybe even worse than a late game Undertaker off the top.
Yeah.
You know, it's
right. In a lot of cases, it can be because at that point, the life totals actually matter a lot yeah. sometimes. So yeah. it's like sometimes it's actually, you can't play it.
Sometimes even worse.
Yeah.
Such an unexciting hand. Yeah. Oh, man. Well, I mean, later on, it's going to be really
better.
Exciting.
It gets better.
Oh, yeah. This thing's going to hit its curve eventually.
Right. Absolutely.
Just give it a few minutes.
Yeah. When he hits nine, man, it's going to be a party.
There are some really high-impact cards in his hand, though. I mean, the Harrison and the Black Knight alone are game-changing cards. How do you feel about the addition of the Ysera to the deck?
Well, you know, Ysera just helps so much right now. So many people are playing Ysera. As soon as the metagame slows down, Ysera becomes one of the best cards in the game. That's just it. Like, you don't ever want to draw it against anything aggressive, but, you know, you're playing a slow game. Yeah. I would count this even as a slow game, despite the fact that he has now six minions out.
Yeah, but there's not really a lot of damage represented on the board. So that,
six minions, three damage.
Yeah, exactly.
half an attack per guy.
Four, excuse me. He has the Searing Totem.
Oh, okay. Jeez, whoa.
Yeah.
Just got this here.
Back up, Reels. Yeah.
Slow your roll, kid.
Reels, I don't know why you hate Searing Totem so much, but you're really biased in your cast. Yeah,
I do hate Searing
Such
Totem.
Such a discrimination.
I hate it too, actually.
Actually there
this
are
This is
times.
Even worse than the owl stuff. He doesn't even count it as a person. No, he's just ignoring it.
Just some wooden thing.
Yeah.
So often, turn two, I'm like, my opponent is a shaman.
Yeah.
I'm like, please, Searing Totem. Please, Searing Totem. Just something that just dies instantly and I don't have to worry about it.
Sometimes it's so scary using your hero power as a shaman. It's like, you know, you want to press it, but at the same time, like, for example, if there's like an Acolyte of Pain down and you roll a Searing Totem, you're just so
it's
sad.
It's the worst.
You're so sad.
Yeah, of course, with... Oh, man. That's the most painful one right there.
That one is just, you want to cry. Sometimes I do.
Rightfully so.
But, yeah, I mean, it makes the shaman a lot of fun, but... It definitely can be tough call sometimes on when to hero power. But being in a situation where you can hero power every turn really is so advantageous.
Well, we haven't seen a Brawl yet, and you know, he's getting kind of late into this.
Maybe he's not playing Brawl.
Now, do you think you just
get rid of
the
fire? It's a possibility, because you have to play around it no matter what, right?
Yeah.
I mean, Brawl, you have to play around.
Yeah. Do you think you just get rid of the Fire Alley with the Cruel Taskmaster Execute? I mean, you can't play Sludge Belcher then, but it feels like you can't really just leave that there. If you play the Sludge Belcher into that, you're just giving it up for free.
Yeah. Plus, the thing is, you're using like two cards on one, and I hate that, but...
But what other options are there?
There really isn't any. It's funny, but you know, these three totems plus these two little dudes make everything a little bit unappealing because they're like such garbage on the board that's going to deal with everything just fine.
Exactly. Like, your opponent doesn't care about losing them.
Yeah. He's not even going to lose him because you got that healing totem.
Yeah, exactly. Plus, I mean, the Zombie Chow trades, you know, nicely into the Taskmaster as well. So, you know, it's definitely a pretty annoying spot.
I wonder if he'll be tempted to use Flame Tongue to try and trade even more efficiently, or if he'll just sort of continue to just play into the board
definitely
the same
could,
way.
But
can he just say that there's no Brawl
there
in hand? I think he can.
Yeah. I think so. After last turn, Brawl coming out, I think you can say that.
Yeah.
Because, you know, the only thing that you wouldn't have wanted to see stay alive was basically the Fire Alley.
Yeah.
So that's pretty ideal Brawl.
Yeah, I mean, especially since you have big turns coming up.
Yeah.
This is exactly what you're afraid of right here, is when this Flame Tongue totem comes down and you're just... This board can do anything to you now. So he definitely does have a Brawl. Yeah. And,
It's one of the most important parts of like about Shaman is when you do have those totems down, they become so powerful in conjunction with the Flame Tongue because you're just trading free minions away nonstop. And until you get some of that big removal, it becomes so difficult to actually get board control back.
Yeah. Oof, this is...
It's kind of a gross turn.
It is. Like, there's just...
You don't want a Black Knight that totem?
No, I know,
come on,
but...
Man.
The value...
It's actually not that bad
a play.
Yeah.
On this board, it's not that bad.
Yeah.
Because the The taunt totem is in the way, and that's going to bring down to one totem, so he's only got 33% chance to taunt and screw with that Black Knight again.
Yeah, I mean, do you think you Urshock this, or do you save the... I think you should just Urshock and save the Hex, right?
Yeah, use some totems to get rid of
it. Just Urshock it.
I think you want to get maximum mileage out of these totems right now. You're just gaining ridiculous advantages by doing that.
Yeah, I completely agree.
I kind of like this, actually. He's probably going to play the Fire Elemental.
Yeah.
So
he's
getting rid of the Zombie Chow while his opponent is as close to 30 as he's ever going to be in this game.
Yeah, it's a nice play.
That is, you're right, that's really quite nicely done. Good usage of that coin.
Yeah, he's held on to it for quite some time. And I mean, the board here, the one saving grace, I guess, is that, you know, we could see Alakir come out, get Black Knighted. That could be something that could, hopefully, for Green Chief's sake, maybe start to turn this around a little bit.
It could happen. We could see easily Alakir as soon as this turn. There is a Flame Tongue Totem.
It
makes it 5 attack, bashes into the Sludge Belcher, takes it out really efficiently.
At the same time, I mean, he has such a powerful board now. Do you think he's going to feel he needs to develop his board more? I mean, with the Healing Stream down, it's not that bad trading just totems into it and stuff as well. I mean, there's a lot of ways you can deal with this. And
using the totems while you can.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because, I mean, it just doesn't cost you anything, and it makes your board less susceptible to Brawl if there ever was one or anything
like
that.
With this Taunt Totem out, like, the thing is, his board can get cleaned up pretty well the next turn. He has to assume that there's some sort of removal spell in his opponent's hand by now, I would say.
But there isn't.
Well, he does have an execute.
Oh, there you go. So, get rid of that Haunted Creeper, no problem.
Well, I mean, he does have the charge from the Death Spite, which is going to damage the Fire Alley, but...
Yeah.
I'm just trying to figure out if you actually want to play... I think that the Alakir is, like... It's kind of funny because it will still have its Divine Shield, which makes it hard to actually deal with this weapon, which you would normally not have that hard of a time.
Yeah.
It's not actually that easy anymore to just proc for this because
for
he's already...
But, but it's the Black Knight. It's the Black Knight that's
that
the problem.
That is true.
Yeah. Ooh, Acolyte is a nice draw.
Yeah. Oh, man, now he's going to be sad.
Wow.
Now he's
going to
be so sad.
This is a turn.
Oof.
Well...
I mean, it's still quite nice, but he spends the Black Knight on a totem. And now Alakir can come down scot-free.
That's true, but
this
turn
still
was
very
awesome.
Clean. Yeah.
Black Knight on the totem, though.
Yeah.
Best I wanted play. It. It happened. I'm happy.
It was really good value as well. Oh, another Flame Tongue, though. Flame Tongue Alakir could be quite nice here as well. I mean, you can clean up the minions with the Flame Tongue, or you can just start going face. I mean, potentially, how much damage do we have here? We have 16 damage that he could do. Mm-hmm. Well, now we can't, but could have put him to 3.
Yeah, could have put him to 3. Could have, would
have. Yeah.
Maybe should have.
I mean, what do you think about that? Do you think he should have done that? Like,
put him really low.
Put him to 3 HP. He could have put him 3 HP.
That, yeah.
With still, you know.
It's pretty good because even if he has Alexstrasza in hand, which so many warrior decks do run, the damage is still on the board.
Yeah, exactly.
So it's
and
a
the Divine Shield
pain.
Would still be up. And, you know, knowing that his Black Knight was already spent seems like it could have been a pretty powerful move.
I think I'm in agreement with you, but it looks like he's kind of choosing to play it a little bit slower.
So,
where are you,
the
buddy?
Comes up, yeah.
Brawl. Why? We wanted to battle.
Do you feel like, I mean, at this point, Ysera seems way too slow to me. Do you feel like you're in a position where you just have to, like, drop the Grommash and start trying to, like, get something done with it?
God, that is...
I mean, it's
I
gross,
don't like
but what? But what's the play? You know, do you brawl here? I mean, it's like none of the turns are very nice.
No, nothing's very nice at all here.
I mean, you could brawl and drop the Harrison after or something like that, but... Then if there's a Doomhammer, you know, you're not too happy about that either. I think it is going to be the Grommash. I mean, it doesn't seem like a great play, but at the same time, there's not a lot of options for him here, and I think he's really feeling the pressure. You know, knowing how slow of a card Ysera is, I just don't think it's the time for it.
The odds of there not being a Hex or Earthshock or something here to deal with this is like he just kind of traded this for a totem and a card from the hand. It's so painful.
Yeah.
Well... Certainly by next turn, it's going to be particularly scary. I'm a bit surprised he didn't play the Defender of Argus that turn. I guess Feral Spirit is just as good unless he top decks something like Rockbiter Weapon. Mm. So,
and especially because he has, you know, he has the other minions in hand. It's not like even if this somehow gets cleared, he can flood the board next turn.
Yeah.
Because there's not going to be 2 brawls. I mean, I think you have to pretty much brawl now.
Oh,
yeah. There's no.
There's nothing else you can do.
You're not going to drop Ysera here, guys.
Are you sure?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure.
Okay.
All right, let's see what comes out of here.
Well, this is, yeah, this is sort of last-ditch effort for Green Sheep here. And fortunately, the Flame Tongue Totem is gone at least.
Yeah, that's very important.
If the Flame Tongue Totem had survived, there'd be those creepers. Oh, Doomhammer, though.
That could actually be interesting if he does decide to play that.
Well, I think that this is almost completely decided at this point. Like, what can Green Sheep even draw to really bring himself back into this?
Brawl number two?
What? If there is one. It's just
we've seen it done. You know, I want to say like, oh, Brawl number two, haha, that's not going to happen. But maybe.
We've seen a lot of two Brawl decks in tournaments in the past month or so.
Yeah.
Or 2 months, I guess. It's really made a resurgence, so.
I feel like you almost just have to drop your Sarah. What else can you do? I mean, you could drop the Harrison and, like, you know, Taskmaster the Wolf and armor up. But, I mean, this is not, like, very nice, right? I mean, he's got to
be... You could shield slam the 1-1 token. Isn't that a sick play?
Yeah, that is.
Oh, and Green Sheep just looks pained.
Yeah, you just drop the Ysera.
I think you just have to, yeah. There's nothing.
You hope for... Well, I don't even know what you're hoping to. I guess you're hoping for Emerald Drake every turn.
You think so?
Yeah.
Emerald Drake?
Yeah. Isn't that the name of
it? Over Ysera Awakens, AoE or something?
Look at how low his health is.
Yeah.
Yeah, over that.
Oh, well, gosh.
He's thinking about the Taskmaster. Maybe he feels his life total is too low to go for that.
Well, if you're not, feel like I mean, that's up. The play where you try to win the game. This is like just trying to stay alive a little bit longer.
Just trying to stay afloat.
Because this dude doesn't do anything, man. He's just going to die and... Oh, that's such a weak turn.
Yeah.
Oh, and a Black Knight on the opposite side. And I don't think we've seen a Sludge Belcher yet from Green Sheep.
Yeah.
Does he equip the Doom?
He had Ascension, though.
Yeah, he did.
Which means...
He did. He's probably playing the Sludge Belchers as well.
Yeah. Yeah, maybe like one Ascension, two Sludge or something.
No, that is not...
Well, he can kill both of the wolves, but he's still... slowly just getting grinded out by the shaman and all the totems. And certainly Doomhammer or Alakir, one or the other, is coming out this turn.
Still, though, I mean, the fact... Oh,
wow. Ooh, maybe it's just going to be Harrison.
Gonna be Harrison, I think.
Yeah.
Why not?
I like it.
he's got some flashy play. That Kranich.
And now, I mean, even the Ysera is... literally nothing. Not that it would have maybe won the game, but still, Hex in hand. He has all the answers.
Yeah. Doesn't even matter what he draws at this point. 12 health, nothing left to do.
Yeah, I think that's going to be it.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, he should be able to finish him off.
8 plus 6 is actually, it's exactly 14 just with Alakir,
even
if he plays Lotheb.
There's nothing he can do.
Mm-hmm. And he has to assume that there are finisher cards in his opponent's hand. He's seen just about everything else played.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, that's going to be
ending up with a
second 3-0.
Really quick 3-0 here.
Yeah, Shaman crushing it, honestly, against Green Sheep here. And you guys talked about, you know, Green Sheep being the one kind of who was supposed to win this match.
Yeah,
well,
but definitely wasn't the case this time.
Yeah, I mean, as far as we knew, he was the favorite in most people's minds.
Yeah,
and
sure.
But Kranich...
crushing it with the Shaman. He's going to take this first series 3-0 over Green Sheep. Very well played.
And that is exactly how you want to do it. Now he has 3 hidden decks and a Shaman deck. And the thing is, the Shaman deck, you look at it, it seems like just basically a normal Shaman deck.
Pretty much.
It has a Harrison in it, so that's like a little piece of information.
He got
to hide
the Black Knight as well. He got to hide some cards that could be pretty important.
Yeah. Yeah. So, great play there by Kranich. It's...
Yeah.
I think we're having a lot of matches go ways that people didn't expect at home. Again, you know, this is something I've been saying a lot. A lot of people are just expecting the Western players to do well, but the Eastern players showing that they have what it takes. Like, a lot of Chinese players have won already. Kranich has now had a victory as well.
Yeah, and moving forward in his group, and so he'll move on to the winner's bracket, and Green Sheep is going to have to fight from behind, and he's not out yet, but it will be a much more difficult road now at this point.
Yeah.
Yeah, the first series is honestly so important, not only just because of the road, but I think for confidence for a lot of these players, especially a young player. I mean, I think it's like Green Sheep, he was like 16 or something
like that.
So, I mean, I think it definitely can weigh on your mind a lot. You know, you can start doubting some of your choices, doubting some of your decks maybe. It obviously depends on the player, depends on the person. Some people are going to be confident no matter what, but for some players, it can make a big difference.
Certainly. You know, this is only really his second really big tournament, I believe. Maybe he did one in between. I didn't really quite see. But still, you know, this is not like a wealth of tournament experience for him. And in fact, I think the same can be said for Kranish. But 3-0-ing with your Shaman deck, you haven't even shown anything yet. You have to be so confident going into the next match.
Yeah, no kidding.
Definitely really nice. I would be happy with that. Especially if there is, maybe there is, maybe there isn't anything kind of wacky going on with his other decks. Or it certainly is Shaman. We know now that he has both Black Knight and Harrison in it. And if he has anything like that in his other decks, that's really important information that now the other players don't know.
Yeah, it's a good point. I mean, especially when you're not playing standard, if you do have some sort of deck that has a bit of a curveball in it, you want to save for later in the tournament, the longer you can hide that, the better it's going to be.
For sure. Well, let's go ahead and take a look at the groups, see where we're at right now after this match. And we do see who we have in that winner's match tomorrow for Group C. It's going to be Kranish going up against Firebat.
Both with 3-0s.
Yeah, they haven't shown anything. That is a scary Miracle deck coming out of Firebat, and of course a very scary Shaman deck. I don't even know if it's very scary. It's just like a Shaman deck with like 2 tech cards in it. So it seems like kind of normal.
He had very good draws. He played it very well, I think. So, you know, it's not something you can read a ton into, but... very strong play, and I mean, going into the winner's match tomorrow, both players having 3-0s have got to have a lot of confidence. Who do you think would be favorite there?
Oh, wow.
Firebat?
I'd go with Firebat still.
I still think Firebat's amazing.
Yeah.
And I would like to think that he's favored against almost anyone in the tournament, save maybe Strifecrow, Kalento, or maybe Tiddler Celestial.
Okay. Yeah.
So, and even then, those are very close matches, not that he's particularly unfavored. So I can't wait for that one. That one's going to be great.
Speaking of two of those players, I mean, Strifecrow is coming up next. Kalento is going to be the last
match.
So
yeah,
those are two
Strifecrow, man. I love me some Strifecrow.
I love Strifecrow, man. He was I was on EG with Strifecrow and stuff.
That's true.
I lived with him for a while
at
the EG house. He's a great guy.
I've just had a crush on him for years. So
big Strifecrow fan.
All right, enough about Strifecrow for now. We'll talk about him in a minute.
Yeah.
Why don't we see what Kranish has to say about that match?
Thank you, guys. This is Kranich's day. Kranich. 3-0.
Yeah, sure.
Really great. Yeah, sure. No thing. Really, really good.
Did you expect to go 3-0?
Not 3-0, but...
But you did expect to win.
Yeah.
It sounds like it. Now, I noticed you came up here, you were like, no translator for me. You actually learned English from watching Twitch? Is that what it's true? No.
Yeah, that was just a joke.
Okay, good. I was worried. I was going to ask you, was it from watching Twitch or Twitch chat?
I don't know why everybody is saying about Twitch chat. I just like to watch some Twitch streams. And there are Twitch chats, and Twitch streamers actually try to speak in English, and I heard that and just try to figure out what to speak in, like here. But Twitch chats are not a good like ocean to me to learn English, I guess.
Yeah, I would agree with that.
So you're back there behind the stage here. You guys are playing. You guys are sitting really close together.
Yeah.
Is it nerve-wracking sitting that close to your opponent?
I don't know. I have no idea because we get close and playing games, but we didn't talk each other, and I don't know what is the main difference. But it seems like cool with sofa and table and some like fires. it was cool.
Well, I'm glad it was a comfortable spot for you guys. You look really comfortable in those giant chairs. I mean, did you find like a good spot? And were you using the mouse or the touchscreen?
I use mouse.
Mouse. It's interesting who chooses to do what. I like the touchscreen. I like to kick back and play, but I'm not a pro, so we're just gonna throw that out.
It's tough to when the timer's running down and you got to move quick. The touchscreen could be a disadvantage. So it is interesting that players are trying.
and I always like my hand has like a lot of sweat and
oh yeah.
I totally understand your.
Yeah. So sometimes I misclick and misplace, but so I individually prefer to use mouse.
Well, I wanted to ask, you're on Team Golden Coin, right?
Yeah.
And Golden Coin got, you were telling me, three of the top four spots at the qualifying tournament?
That's true.
So, did you, who didn't make it? Who wasn't here with you guys?
What?
Which teammate didn't make it with you guys?
It was Transit.
Oh. Yeah.
Transit was actually a very good player at CN versus KR Masters 1, but I don't think he's good.
Oh. Are you watching? Yeah. Are you watching right now, Trans?
Actually, he retired for to study. But.
He's coming back now. He's going to come back just to play
okay.
you. Well, I mean, you have a great team. You obviously worked very hard to get here. Is there anything you want to say to all the fans watching at home?
Okay. So what I want to say is that Korean players are quite new in this Hearthstone scene. And people may think that Korean players are bad and not good to compete in this kind of tournament. But I don't think at all like that. And I just really want to prove to all the Hearthstone fans to like Korean players are good enough to win this kind of tournament. And Rennie Auer had actually. He's won losing his group stage, but I think he can like recover and get through the group stage, and I really want to him like go to Blaziken stage with him. Okay, so yeah, I'll do my best.
Would that mean a lot for you guys to go together?
Left?
Would that mean a lot to you to go together to the BlizzCon stage as teammates?
Yeah, sure.
Sure, yeah. You know, that was emotional until I asked my question. So that was beautiful thoughts from you, Krenich.
Okay.
Well, thank you so much. Congratulations.
Huge win, 3-0. Well done.
Thanks a lot.
Absolutely wonderful. And you know what? We've got some more games still coming up. So stay tight, guys. See you soon.
Of Draenor. Boost to level 90 and take your place on the front lines. Rated T for Teen.
Welcome back, guys, to the World Championships of Hearthstone.
Yeah, we nailed it that time.
We have an I'm getting a little bit better. I thought Frodan was going to come over and save me this time. Didn't happen, unfortunately. It's going to be us three jobbers with you once again.
Yep.
And going to be a lot of fun. I do believe Strifecrow is playing next, right?
Yeah, we've got Group D, final group of the day.
That's right.
D stands for death in this case.
Well, it's going to be Run and Gun, who's done pretty well over there in China and in the OGN Masters Series. And he's going up against Strifecrow, who is, he has really trained for this. Like, Strifecrow has been one of the best players since the beginning of Hearthstone, like when it first came out.
Yeah.
I remember I played against him when I was trying to practice for the last BlizzCon, and I was like, oh my god, you are just so good at this game. You just, like, crushed me over and over and over. And, I think he's actually going to win this because for the first time, he is really taking a tournament seriously. Like, he's played in all these tournaments, he's done well, he's won some tournaments. Especially back at the beginning of Hearthstone. But for this one, he's actually been practicing a ton with other really great players, and he feels confident coming in.
Yeah, and we'll see how that matches up against, even in this match, just Run and Gun, who I'm sure has done his own preparations, and maybe Strifecrow will not have been prepared for exactly what Run and Gun is doing. I hope he is. I am definitely, you know, a little bit more of a Strifecrow fan in this one, but... I agree. He's just been so scary for so long, and if this is the tournament where he says, okay, I'm really trying now, like, look out.
Yeah, and I mean, it's like we talked a little bit before, you know, what more motivation do you need than BlizzCon? So it's like, you know, for some of the players that maybe, you know, they're really good, they're very talented, but they haven't taken their training as seriously, this can be kind of the kick in the butt to actually, you know, step it up a bit with that. And it sounds like that is what it's been for Strife Crow. But at the same time, do you think for a player like Strife Crow, who's been in so many tournaments, who has so much information on him out there, do you think that's a little bit of a disadvantage in some ways too? For because Run and Gun can sit down and he could just watch days and days of Strife Crow games.
That's true.
Do you think that, you know, he could, you know, maybe try to find some tendencies, some weaknesses there, and try to exploit that?
Well, I think so. Yeah, you can. You by watching a player, you can figure out the way that they play, and he definitely has a way that he plays. Like Strife Crow battles for the board.
Yeah,
I'm gonna spoiler that for you.
Yeah.
He battles for the board all the time.
Yeah.
But let me paint it this way. So if I were to say Strife Crow and you were to name a class, what
druid.
Would you say?
Druid.
Take a look at Strife Crow's decks and tell me what you see.
I don't see a druid.
How much do you really know about Strife Crow?
Well, those classes were coming in. But
that's right.
He is known for druid. That's for sure.
Yeah, and but the reality is that he is a very well-rounded player.
Mm-hmm.
He's a player who makes great decisions.
Yeah.
And saying he always fights for the board or something like that, or a player like, oh, he likes to go to the face, is putting them in a box that isn't necessarily true. For some players, it might be more true. I think for Strife Crow, it's less true.
I think it's hard. A tendency, though. I mean, you know, he's one of the players that I've seen doing plays like just dropping Argus and stuff to fight for board, you know, without taunting anything up. Mm-hmm. Just valuing the minion, Argus, and just to get it down. Like things like that, like you do talk about. You know, he does battle aggressively for the board. It's not necessarily a weakness. And it's not necessarily something he's going to do, you know, ridiculously. But
yeah.
there can be tendencies found, or at least, you know, some sort of playstyle that maybe Run and Gun can try to gain some advantage from.
Maybe. I think maybe you can know kind of what he's like, but I think it's harder to turn that into an advantage. So we'll have to see whether Run and Gun can actually pull that off. What he can do, he has a paladin on his lineup as well.
Okay.
So we might actually get to see a paladin. I doubt it will get banned this time.
Yeah.
And
it definitely, I can't imagine Strife Crow banning paladin.
So if you're Run and Gun, right? Yeah. Put himself in it. You're saying Strife Crow is the tournament favorite. So you're coming into this tournament. Do you come in with standard decks, or do you just say, what can I think of that he won't have seen before?
Well, you got to play to win the tournament,
though,
right?
I think you got to...
Not just that match.
Yeah, like, it's good to, if you win, if you can, like, snipe Strife Crow really hard,
mm-hmm.
I guess that can win you, like, an extra 2.5 grand, maybe, because maybe you kill him once or twice in the group stage, but then you're going to fall to somebody. Like, the decks aren't going to end up working.
So you think you just have to go standard no matter what?
I would think so, but his lineup doesn't look very standard to me.
Yeah.
He's playing Shaman Priest, Warlock, Paladin. So a little bit different, a little bit more controlling, it looks like.
Yeah.
Speaking of which, I did want to bring up with you guys, Strife Crow is the only player in his group that brought a Hunter deck. What do you guys think about that? Because Strife Crow, I was talking to him yesterday, and he was actually saying that he was pretty surprised that he was the only one in his group to bring Hunter.
Yeah. Well, it seems like the meta is maybe shifting a little bit. We're not seeing hunters as be as successful. Players maybe figuring out a little bit more things like the addition of zombie chows and stuff in decks can definitely help against it.
That's true.
But you know, a lot of it obviously has, I think, in some of those matches, come down to kind of the draws for the opponents, and maybe Strife Crow is playing a different version of the deck. Who knows?
It is true though that the times that we have seen Hunter, it's been getting pretty easily defeated.
Yeah.
And the rest of the time it's been banned. So does that mean that if those players had not banned it, that they also would have easily defeated it? Or are we just seeing some weird skewed thing where it makes us think Hunter isn't any good?
I don't know exactly.
But I think we need a bigger sample size.
Yeah,
though.
I mean. If Strife Crow says he's surprised people didn't bring Hunter, and he's been practicing specifically with Gaara and some other players, Gaara who just got second at the DreamHack Bucharest Masters, like this morning or something, I mean, these are some smart guys, and I kind of trust them that Hunter's good. It's been so good for so long. It's been so consistent. So, I mean, I guess we'll just wait and see if that Hunter deck really does a good job for him.
And whether it's the Hunter
deck
or not.
Might even get banned, right?
Yeah, it definitely could. And you know what? If they're going to ban it, fine. The Hunter's banned.
Kind of done its job a bit.
That means he gets to play Warlock, and that's fantastic.
Yeah, exactly.
Supposedly, somewhere in Strife Crow's lineup of decks, there may be some deck that's off the beaten path a little bit.
Oh, yeah?
Maybe that means just the rogue deck is a style of Miracle, kind of like Firebats that you don't see very often.
Could be.
Or, because you could say that's kind of off the the beaten path. You know, Firebat just recently won his match 3-0 with the I got to watch it from the sidelines. Yeah. The what's his name? The haha, the pirate.
yeah, South Sea Deckhand.
Yep. Copy. GG. So yeah. That was pretty awesome. Maybe it's something like that, or maybe it's something going on with one of his other decks.
Well, you know, I think we've seen every iteration of Hunter that's possible at this point. Okay, anyone who's played enough Hearthstone definitely has. Warlock really has the two types,
yeah.
Which leaves Shaman and Rogue. So I would say it's one of those two that would be a little bit different.
I mean, there can definitely be a lot of variations of Shaman, I think. Like, you know, for a while there was kind of the giant Shaman. There's kind of like more standard mid-range Shaman. There's kind of the bursty stuff like Double Doomhammer, Lava Burst type decks. There are like a lot of different variations that players can make. And then there is kind of the standard decks that players can take and give little changes to maybe make them stronger against the late game or early game, you know, things like the Black Knight and Harrison and stuff.
What if it's something crazy like Undertaker Shaman or Undertaker Rogue?
It could be like a backspace rogue or something like that.
Undertaker Shaman is basically like the Giants deck.
Someone
right?
just brought to a tournament. Someone really good. Was it Hyped that brought Sea Giant Shaman to a tournament?
Yeah.
Someone did this. Was it him?
I think so.
I think so. Yeah. That's weird. That's out there. Yeah.
I was playing that for a while, and I actually the deck that I
you I, personally I, were playing it.
Yeah.
Okay.
I copied it from a tournament, but it had Undertakers in it and stuff too. It was actually a pretty wacky deck, but it was fun on ladder.
All right. Well, we're gonna go ahead and throw it over to Rachel and Ben Brody. I think they have some special guests here.
Brode.
Yeah. Thank you so much, guys. We made some friends over here. Ben Brode and I. We found some of these StarCraft casters. They're from StarCraft, right? We got Apollo. We got Tasteless. And I'm getting booze in my ear. I don't know who that is, but I'm happy to see you, Ben. Do you know these guys?
Hell yeah.
Oh yeah. So that's all I get from that. But I noticed you guys didn't have to be here today. You came around to check out some Hearthstone, Apollo. What do you like about Hearthstone?
I don't really play any Hearthstone, but I come to watch some games.
See, wait, I heard yesterday that you played a best of three against somebody who's about to play, and you crushed. Is that true?
Yeah, Strifecore, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I beat him yesterday.
So what decks were you guys playing yesterday?
Hunter. Mage.
And Mage.
A Freeze Mage.
Okay, so I'm beginning an idea here where you play the games, but there seems to be a different mastermind behind this. So, Tasteless, talk me through your coaching of this young Padawan.
I haven't been able to coach him yet, but I do play a lot of Hearthstone. I got to level 2 last season.
That's pretty impressive. Level 2, right under the legendary.
Like you got.
I'm like 2 in the world actually.
Oh yeah, no.
He means he unlocked his first basic card. He's very excited.
Yeah, man, but it's a great game. I love it. I'm going to get you soon, Apollo.
We're going to play, man. I don't know.
It's really good. I'm really good at it. I just don't really know what I'm doing. And I seem to win, man.
That's just beginner's luck. Once you get out of the 20 rank, it starts to change, I assure you.
I don't know the ranking system.
This is feigned ignorance, I'm certain. I feel like he spends hours slaving away. He's going to make the switch really soon from casting high-level StarCraft to casting... Yep, for your job's over there on the couch. So, but you actually, Nick, Tasteless Plot, you play a lot of Hearthstone. What is your favorite class right now?
I like Warlock. I've been doing Handlock a lot, and some Zoo. I will admit that. I do some Zoo decks. But, yeah.
I'm proud. I'm glad you're playing Zoo. I play Zoo. I play with, something special, though. I play with the Golden Elite Torn Chieftain from BlizzCon last year.
Because nice.
Nothing feels better, man, than slapping down an ETC when you've already won. I wouldn't recommend this for everybody.
You can only do it when you've already won.
Sometimes with the Knife Juggler and then the Murloc. No, it's not a strategy. Okay. No, can we get a check from the pros? Is that okay? No. You know what? There's a reason I'm over here.
Thumbs up from Frodan. He likes it.
Nice. Frodan's in. So what do you play in your Zoo? Anything fun?
Well, it's Zoo, so it's not that fun. I mostly just, I mean, you know, I just probably get, you know, early drops and, you know, get lucky with the Knife Juggler. Yeah, Voidwalker.
Yeah, right.
All that. But yeah.
All right. Well, I think we've milked this cow for all it's worth. Ben, any last words?
You guys at home probably can't see this setup here, but it's really cool. This is a great, it's like a little tavern bar kind of deal. It's really it's hard to get a full view of it. We got a nice couch with the casters hanging out. It's great. It's a great way to watch Hearthstone.
It is a great way, and it's attracted some people that you wouldn't normally see hanging around Hearthstone. So hopefully, if you guys got some friends at home, bring them in, have them check out the show, see if they like it too. And you know, we're gonna get our converts. We're gonna make everybody play Hearthstone by the end of the weekend. So thank you so much, guys. We're gonna go to a short break. When we come back, more games.